Lord, we just thank you for this day, Father. We thank you for the weather that you've brought us, Lord, that it's not freezing cold, but it's not so hot you can't breathe. And Father, we just pray that you will just help us to hear what the Spirit is saying to us individually today, Father. Help us to be open to hear your Spirit. And Father, I pray that you will just guide my words and allow whatever to be said that you would have said today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, we have been starting with this book called I Am a Church Member by Dr. Tom Rainer. And Pastor Bob and I had spoken about this, gosh, it's been a little over a year ago. And we just waited for the right time to actually bring out the series, and we feel like now is the time. And so, again, if you did not get a copy of last week's, it's up there in the CD and the DVD so that you can kind of get caught up on where we are right now. I am a church member. How many church members we have in here? All right. Well, last week we talked about the introduction, and the introduction to the book gave us this insight on a tale of two church members. And we saw two different men and how they looked at the church. The first person that we looked at was Liam. Liam was an angry person. We'll just say that this is him, even though that's not him. He was angry, frustrated. He was frustrated with the sins and the inadequacies of the members of the church. He was always grumbling and complaining, and he spent more time focusing on things that were wrong instead of seeing the other members through God's loving eyes. Liam believed that his church was full of hypocrites. He also had an unrealistic expectation of his pastor, and he felt like his pastor just didn't do what he wanted him to do. He was not a happy person. Liam was a member of his church with the same mentality as some would have when they join a country club. What perks am I going to get after I pay my money? Who's going to feed me? Who's going to take care of me? And that's the mentality that Liam had when he went to church. What can this church offer me? Well, there was another man. His name was Michael. Hey! Imagine that. All right, high five. Michael was enthused about his church. He was enthused. He contributed. He was a servant. He served. He didn't think about, you know, oh, Pastor Bob, you don't have a tie on today. I cannot believe you didn't wear a tie. See, he didn't focus on all that stuff. Michael contributed. He was a servant. He focused on functioning in God's plan that God had for his life, not on anyone else. Not trying to correct anyone. Michael was a member of his church with the mentality that he was there to serve and care for others, to pray for the leaders, to learn, to teach, to give, and to be an active member. A lot of people join churches for many reasons. Some join because they expect something in return. It's time for us as a body of believers to give instead of feeling like we're entitled to something. Amen? Amen? The first thing that we learned last week, one of the first things, is in 1 Corinthians 13:5. It, or love, does not hold grudges and will hardly even notice when others are doing it wrong. How many of you remember the Sadducees and the Pharisees? What did they do when Jesus came on the scene? Yeah, yeah, him, this, him, that. They started talking about this man who was blaspheming the Lord. Instead of getting in the scriptures and reading through and seeing, could this be him? Could this be the Messiah? They were condemning him. Let me just say this. It wasn't the sinners who put Jesus on the cross that day. It was the religious people, the religious who couldn't see past the do's and don'ts of Scripture to see that they had the Messiah standing right in front of them. Amen? So love hardly notices when others do it wrong. The second thing we learned last week is how important it is to know what your gifts are. A lot of people don't know what their gifts are. Now, I promised you I'd have the gift assessment test, and I have brought it. So for those of you who have never taken this test, take the time to do it. And I want to encourage you not to look at the last pages until you've actually taken the test, because you might find, oh yeah, that's me. And then when you start reading through the questions, you'll be like slanted towards one thing or another. And you want to make sure that you're being as honest and truthful about every single question when you answer it, no matter what. Okay, it's only between you and the Lord doing this test anyway. If you want to share it with someone later, Pastor Bob or one of the leaders, feel free to do that so that we know what your gifts are. But it's not something you mandatorily have to do. It's good to know what your gifts are. Let's read in Romans 12, and we're going to read chapter 12, verse 4, and we're going to read all the way up to verse 6a in the Amplified. For as in one physical body we have many parts, and a lot of us have heard the scripture. If you were here last week, you've already heard the scripture. We have many parts, organs, members, and all of these parts do not have the same function or use. Verse 5, so we, numerous as we are one body in Christ the Messiah. And individually, we are parts of one another, mutually dependent on one another. Verse 6, having gifts, faculties, talents, qualities that differ according to the grace given us, let us use them. And we're going to stop right there. I know Willie Tillman's gifts because I have known him since I was a teenager. I know your gifts because I've been here for 21 years and I've watched many of you. I know your gifts because I'm seeing them. You're using your gifts, but I want you to dig just a little bit deeper. I like to talk to some of the older folks tonight. Before long, I'm going to be your age. And I hope someone reminds me of what I'm getting ready to share with you. Had the opportunity to speak to an elderly group of people at a Baptist church. It was about as big as this room, loaded down with elderly folks. And they invited me when I was like 30 to come in and speak to them. I thought, wow, first of all, I'm a woman minister in a Baptist church. Second of all, these are all elderly people learning from a young person who is a female minister. So it was definitely a God thing. But what I said to them and what I wanted them to know, if you look in the Word, how many elderly people do you see ministering? A lot. God is not finished with you. Your job has just begun. What you teach me as a younger person in the world, what you teach your children, other young people and marriages, couples that are married, what we pass on to that generation is going to make a difference the generation after that, the generation after that, and so on. Your life matters. You know, I know of someone sitting in here right now, just retired this past year, and something just happened. Next thing you know, they're out and got their full-blown ministry going on. Life doesn't stop. Your gifts do not stop flowing just because you turn 65. They are still there. God will use them in a mighty way. So as we talked last week, we talked about how we are such a part of each other, and that as each person functions, that is what being a church member is all about. The first chapter was called, I am a functioning church member. Let's all say that. I am a functioning church member. So find out what those gifts are if you don't know what they are and start using them. And if you don't feel like you have an avenue to use them, call me. Call Pastor Bob. We'll make sure that you have an opportunity to use those gifts in some way, shape, or form. And we will encourage you in those gifts. All right. And I did have homework last week for everyone to read 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Through 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Raise your hand if you read those. Do not have any condemnation with this. Good job. Awesome. You will have one more week to do your homework. Please write this down. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 12 through 1 Corinthians chapter 14. I will not forget to ask you next week if you have read. Amen. Romans 12. We're going to check this scripture out. again. We've looked at this before, but I'd like to see it again. Right here. For as in one physical body, we have many parts. And that's what I want you to see. Do you know what parts of the body are here today? Look around you. Yeah, you know them by name. But what parts of the body are here today? An encourager. A teacher. Not just any teacher, though, I might say. Another encourager. I mean, know the gifts that are around you. And when you need encouragement, who are you going to go to? The Lord first, right? But if you need some, just like, man, I just need a word. Just tell me something nice, please. You know, go to those people that you know that are going to build you up and encourage you. Amen? All right. Again, in the first chapter, we learn how important it is to be a functioning church member. There's a quote by Benjamin Franklin that I saw downtown. How many of you have ever visited Charleston as if you were a tourist? I mean, I have never done that until last year. Just visit and just go. Just walk around downtown at night and just enjoy the cool air. And, oh, there's ice cream. Let's go get the ice cream. Or, oh, there's food. Oh, wow, they're having a party upstairs. Let's go upstairs and look down over Charleston and see how beautiful it is. I took Joey with me. We just went and had a blast. But we got to see what it was like to enjoy. Well, while we were downtown, I saw this on the wall, this quote. And it has stuck with me ever since. Let's go ahead and look at the first part. All mankind. All mankind is divided into three classes. Those who are immovable. Doesn't matter what you tell them, doesn't matter what you say or do, they are not going to move. Next, those who are movable. You know, you can move them a little bit or sway their opinion or talk to, you know, they're movable. And this is the part that really stuck out. And those that move. I want to be that person that moves. I don't want to have to be told it's time to move. I don't want to be the one that's stiff-necked and prideful and can't be moved at all. Hard-hearted. I want to move when God says move. Amen? Benjamin Franklin. Those that are moved by the Holy Ghost. And those that move by the Holy Ghost. That was added by Pastor Bob. Awesome. Now we've talked about we are functioning church members. That was our last week's summary of what we've already gone over. This week we're talking about this. I will be a unifying church member. A unifying. Yes, I'm going to be a functioning church member, but I want to be a unifying church member. The word unify means to make or become united, uniform or whole, to make or become a single unit, unite, to make into a unit or a coherent whole. Years ago, we had Kurt Frisk, love Kurt Frisk, third generation woodworker from Sweden, passed away at 80 years old. Strong as an ox, walked in the door one day with a gentleman that he picked up off the street, literally. I think he kind of had to pick him up to put him in the car. He was drunk, he stunk, he didn't have an idea what was going on, I don't think. I mean, anybody probably could have picked him up and put him in the car. But Kurt's heart as an evangelist was full of love, and he could have cared less. And you know what? He brought him in, and that man sat right there. Not that chair, but right there. And can I tell you, every single person in this church responded the same way Kurt did. Nobody held back and said, oh, I can't walk up to him. Nobody did any of that. Everybody grabbed a hold of him and hugged on him. Good to have you here, sir. So glad you're here. And he's like, Can I tell you, we ministered to his spirit. Whether he was coherent in the flesh or not, we ministered. You know how long it probably was since that man had a hug or someone say hi or pick him up for that and probably fed him afterwards and everything else. But we were a unified church. We all were a single unit that day. We came together and we came together for a purpose, and that was to show love to that man that came into this place, no matter what. And that is what I believe God wants from his body. No matter what, we're to step forward as a whole. Last week I talked about how different churches have different anointings, different callings. Just like Josh has a calling, you have a calling, you have a calling, an anointing on your life. Churches also have individual callings. One might be called for evangelism. One might be called a missionary. One might be a prophetic church, a teaching church. Many different types of churches. And it's important that we find the church that we are a part of, that we feel like we are part of their family. We are all family, this church, that church, and I get that. I'm not trying to segment us. But for your growth in the area that you're called in, you need to surround yourself with people that can help you grow in your anointing and your calling. Many of you already know, the shield of faith is a hospital. There are those that are here that are doctors and nurses and caregivers and counting out the pills. Okay, you need your gospel today? You know, there are those who continually build up anybody that walks through that door. And a lot of times people will come in, they're here for a season, they get healed up, and they'll go back. Hey, guess what? Sometimes they come back, they need a little extra healing or a little extra hug, a little extra love. That, you know, and that's okay. That is who we are. That is what this church has become. And it doesn't matter who it is. You have all stepped up to the plate. I don't know of anybody that can make cake like that lemon cake you bring here, Justine. I have tried others, and it's not near as good. Does she have an anointing to make cake or what? Use it to God's glory. My address is 12. No. Seriously, whatever you do, whatever you do. How many of you have enjoyed when we have a celebration, when we are having Christmas or a baby shower, whatever, and we walk into that room back there and it's like, whoa, it's decorated. It takes a lot of time to do that. Between Linda and Susan and Missy and you guys all pitched in. And what about at the end after we're done eating on Sunday? There's somebody here with a vacuum cleaner. Someone over there is washing dishes. Someone's packing up food. Hey, packing it up for these young whippersnappers that are going home with a box because they got something they can heat up tomorrow. That's ministry, folks. We're unified as a whole, working together to take care of one another. It's important. I will be a unifying church member. Let's say that. I will be a unifying church member. There's a story that God gave me. This is not in the book, but this is a story that he laid on my heart as I was reading. If you guys stick it out through this series, the last day that we have the series, we're going to make sure every family gets a copy of this book. That way you can take it home and read it, because I'm not teaching this verbatim. There's certain excerpts I take out and kind of go with it, but let's look at Judges, chapter 6, verse 1. And we're going to read from verse 1 all the way to verse 6. This is a story that will tie in to what being a unifying church member is all about. But the Israelites did evil in the sight of the Lord. Now, right before this happened, Deborah was judge. They had had 40 years of peace. Everything was going great. And then all of a sudden, people started slipping. They started forgetting the Lord, started setting up idols and you know, worshiping Baal and all these other things. So here we have the Israelites doing evil in the sight of the Lord. And the Lord gave them into the hand of Midian for 7 years. That means they were captured and under the rule of the Midianites. Verse 2. And the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel. Because of Midian, the Israelites made themselves dens, which are in the mountains and the caves and the strongholds. They were trying to hide. So they would go up into the mountains and they would make these caves and they would pull stones out and find these nooks and all to hide. Now you're getting ready to find out why. Verse 3, for whenever Israel had sown their seeds, the Midianites and the Amalekites and the people of the east would come up against them. Verse 4, they would encamp against them, against Israel, and destroy the crops as far as Gaza and leave no nourishment for Israel. No ox, no sheep, no donkey. Verse 5, for they came up with their cattle and their tents. They came like locusts for multitude. Both they and their camels could not be counted. So they wasted the land as they entered it. Verse 6. And Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites, and the Israelites cried to the Lord. Israel was planting seeds. They were doing what they knew to do to have a harvest. They planted all these seeds, and the Midianites and the Amalekites came in, brought all their camels and all their people, and they just, yeah, let's just take it up. And they would take their crops. And so the Israelites were running to the hills for safety, because they didn't want to get hurt. So they were kind of like, go ahead, you guys are over us, who are we? And so they were put under that bondage. Now you have to read the rest of that chapter to find out what happened. I'll give you a hint. Gideon happened. Midianites. The root word to Midianite is this. Brawling. Contention. A contest or a quarrel. Discord and strife. Discord, strife. As a body of believers, we plant seeds constantly. We're wanting to bless someone or speak a word of encouragement. We're using our gifts and planting seeds. But what happens is we let discord come in. We let strife come in and steal it all. And then we wonder why we're hiding in the rocks. Midianites devastated Israel. Discord and strife will devastate a body of believers. Amen. Will devastate. It will destroy the unity in a body in a skinny minute. Now we know each other. We know our strong points. We know our weak points. We don't want to tempt our brothers and sisters. We don't want to encourage them to gossip about other people. We want to be a unified body. And in order to do that, we have to do something that our human nature doesn't want to do. We don't want to cause conflict. Let me explain that. If someone comes up to Justine and says, hey, Justine, girl, did you see what Michelle just did? Did you just watch what she just did? Can you believe she did that? Now, she doesn't want to cause conflict with me because human nature, we don't want conflict. We don't want to say, hey, let's pray.
Yeah, that's great.
You know? Well, first of all, we don't want to pray. I mean, we got to pray out loud. And now we want to tell that person we're not going to have this conversation. Right. And we have to be confident enough to say, we really shouldn't talk about what she just did. Let's pray. Let's just pray. Susan got Floyd with that one time. He told that story. He came and he wasn't really like slandering somebody or anything, but he had something to say and he shared it. And she said, let's pray, honey, and grabbed his hands and just started praying. Oh. In Judges 6, verse 16, and this is in the New King James Version, and the Lord said to him, spoke to Gideon, surely I will be with you, and you shall defeat the Midianites as one. How are we going to defeat the strife and the conflict that comes into a body? When we stand as one. I won't let anyone talk about this man right here. I won't let anyone talk about any of you. Someone come up to me and have something nasty to say? I'm always doing like this. Okay, we're just not going to be here right now. But I've gotten to the point where it is, let's pray. Amen? We protect one another. I would like for you to have a little look around the room. I know you guys have noticed these signs all over the place. Flowers, decor, money, all these things that we could talk about and argue about. We've got all of our opinions on how things should be and what we should do and how we should act. I mean, we do. It's okay to have an opinion. It's okay to share what you feel and what your opinion is. You know what? You may have a better way of doing something than I do or than someone else does. And there's nothing wrong with sharing your heart. Is there? Not at all. Not at all. But say I take our conversation about tithes and offerings and money, and I put it right here on the floor. Willie and Willie, can I have you guys come up here for a second, if you don't mind? And if you'll stand over here on this side and grab that little string right there. I know you've been working all day, and I know you're probably the last person I should have called up here. Out in the heat, working and working and working. I'm sorry, hon. And you grab that side over there. Now, we have this discussion on money right there. And he's got his opinion, and he's got his opinion. And they've shared their opinions about that money. Don't pull it. Don't you try to get your way and go that way. Huh? Don't you try? What? Now we have a tug of war going on here. Now they're not just talking about what they think should happen. They're trying to get their way. And guess, my Lord have mercy. Guess who's going to win? That's right. You know who's going to really win? The person who drops their side. They both want to win. Way to go. Woo! Thank you. Nobody wins a tug of war. Somebody always ends up in the mud. It's okay to share, but don't fight about it. Don't break up the church talking about, well, I think praise and worship should be this way, and I think it should be that way, or I think the outreach ministry, we should do more in the ministry. We should, oh, women in ministry. I don't like what Michelle's saying. We should not have women in ministry anymore. Let's get rid of that. Oh, tithing? No, we don't want to do that. Really? Oh, wait. The flowers. We can have conversations on everything you see on this wall in here. But when it's all said and done, does it really matter? What matters is your heart has been given to the Lord Jesus Christ, and you are serving him 100%, nothing held back, nothing turned up. You are moving and functioning in what he's called you to do. Unifying. God will bless those who are loving one another. Loving. It's the love. And we're going to see that here as we go on in these scriptures. Amen. Love. Love. Walking in the Spirit. John 13:35 says this. By this. Oh, we're getting ready to find something out. By this. All men and women know that you are my disciples if you love one another, if you keep on showing love among yourselves. if an individual who doesn't go to church here walks in and they hear us talking about, well, I can't believe they're going to have that event on Friday night. Of all nights to have it Friday night. I've got plans Friday night. They should have it on Saturday night or Sunday night. They don't even have services on Sunday night. Blah, 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 blah. And they hear us talking. You know what they're going to do? Bye. Because if you're talking about it like that here openly in front of them, they know that they're the ones going to get talked about next. So they're like, whoa, I'm out. All right. There's a couple little excerpts, like I said, that I like to share from this book. And I'm going to kind of read what Dr. Rayner shared here. It's very interesting. God desires for Christians, and I should really put my glasses on, because if I read the wrong words, it's not going to sound right at all. Trust me. Hello. This is on page 21 and 22 of this book. God desires for Christians to get along. In fact, he's emphatic about it. Jesus was clear when he said, "By this all people will know that you're my disciples if you have love for one another." Did you get that? The world will know if we are Christians or not by the way we who are believers act towards one another. Have you ever been to an ugly business meeting in a church? Yep. Do you think an outsider would have been impressed with the Christian behavior that she witnessed? Probably not. Have you ever heard Christians gossip about other Christians? Is that a loving example, loving one another? Look at your pastor's email inbox if he'll let you. I bet some of you would be shocked by what some church members say to him. When you become a Christian, God expects you to be a part of his church. But when you become a part of his church, he wants you to be a unifying presence there. Let's state that a bit more strongly. He demands that you become a unifying presence there, and the evidence is pretty clear. So we're going to take a look at that. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 10. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 10. But I urge and entreat you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in perfect harmony, la la la, and full agreement in what you say, and that there be no dissensions or factions or divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in your common understanding and in your opinions and judgments. What? Perfectly united in your way of thinking? Wow. Perfectly united in our way of thinking. What does that really mean? Oh, that just means that, you know. And we come up with all these ideas of what it really should mean, right? Perfectly united in your common understanding and in your opinions and judgments. And judgments. When you have a common guidebook, we work at New Leaf Landscape Construction. We have a manual. When a holiday comes, I bet you, I can honest to God say that those guys are opening those paychecks looking for that holiday pay. Michelle, did you click on the holiday pay? Because it's in the manual. And we get paid. And if you didn't pay me, it says it right here. I want my pay. When you have a manual, everyone functions according to that manual. And if anyone doesn't do what's in that manual, I'm sorry, but they can't work there. Now, we have grown as a company. It used to be extremely lenient. People could get away with all kinds of stuff. And we still have some of that now. But we've grown. We now have a manual that we didn't have 10 years ago. And now we're working towards more unity among our members of our team. The Bible is our standard. It is our manual as a Christian. If it says it, do this or don't do that, that's what we live by. That's what we live by. Now, if I see somebody out there not doing what the Word says, I might come over to you and say, hey, what are you doing, man? Am I going to do that? No, because it says love one another. Love hardly notices when others do it wrong. You can find a religious person so easy by just even looking at their face sometimes, because they're always focused on the negative, always focused on, you need to do this, or you need to do that. Why are you wearing that? Why do you look like that? And it's so burdensome, it can kill a person's spirit. I lived in that when I was growing up. Now, my father is the most encouraging man you will meet today, but I felt as if I was targeted. Now, many of you may have raised, you know, have been raised in those same situations where you just didn't feel like you could ever do anything right. Your Heavenly Father is not like that. Your Heavenly Father, like I said when we were worshiping, He died for our past sins, our present sins, and our future sins. He knew what we were going to do before we even did it. He knew what we were going to do when we were still in our mother's womb. And He still died for every one of us because He loves us. He loves us. Now, if you had a child and that child comes and does all these crazy things and you're like, oh, some of you have had kids like that, I know. And you're like, oh, they did that. Did you disown them? Did you say, I ain't going to have none of that? No. You wrapped your arms around them and you love them. You take them in and you nurture them back to health. You nurture them. Nurture, I believe, is something that the Holy Spirit embeds in us. It is not something you can just learn overnight. But the Holy Spirit, as we listen to the Holy Spirit and we're moved by that compassion and we are moved by the Holy Spirit, the nurturing of the Holy Spirit reaches from us to other people. But we have to be led by the Holy Spirit and not just the black and white of Scripture. We have to be led by the Lord. And all of us have baggage. All of us have baggage. All of us are in a process. Everyone say process. You feel like you're in a processor, but it is a process. And God is doing the work. It's okay to let Him. It's okay to cry. It's okay to let the Holy Spirit touch those areas that have never been touched before. It's okay. You are in a body here at the Shield that will embrace you and love you through it, no matter what it is. Miss Susan, how many of you have been rocked in the rocking chair by Miss Susan? All right, y'all laughing, but you know you were in that chair with her. In grown woman in a rocking chair, rocking you. Absolutely. Same here. Oh, yeah, I know, right? In the nursery, you got it all the time. You're lucky. Lucky. God is so awesome. That loving nurture, we need that. Amen. All right. Let's go to this next question. And just think about it. Don't want you to answer it out loud yet, but how do you contribute to the unity of the church? Individually, how do you feel that you contribute on purpose to the unity of the church? I have to stop and think too. What do I do that causes unity? Let's look at Colossians 3, verses 14 through 15. We're talking about love. And above all these things, put on love. Stop right there a minute. I never saw this until just now. Sometimes we have to put it on because it's not there yet.
That's right. That's good.
Sometimes we are looking at all the negative, and we do see what's wrong all the time. We have to choose to put on love and not look at those things. And enfold yourself. Wow, you know what I just thought of? My great-grandmother had these curtains, these drapes, that just like from the ceiling all the way to the floor, and I would get up in them and just... She didn't like that too much. Enfold yourself with the bond of perfectness, which binds everything together completely in ideal harmony. Love. Next verse. And let the peace, soul harmony, which comes from Christ, rule and act as an umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds. Wait a minute. Remember that scripture before we were talking about how we're going to be in unity in our thinking? Let's read that again. And let the peace, soul harmony, which comes from Christ, rule, act as an umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds. In that perfect state, all questions that arise in your minds. So Willie and I, we may think a little bit differently. I like Breyer's strawberry ice cream, and I know you like Breyer's vanilla ice cream.
Yes.
I think strawberry's better.
Vanilla's better.
But guess what? It's both Breyers.
Yeah.
They're both Breyers.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. We just agreed. Mm-hmm. We just agreed on something. No? They're both still Breyers ice cream.
Mm-hmm.
Every situation that we have, that there's a disagreement, find the common ground. Find it and settle it immediately. Find the common ground. Well, I think the Old Testament with the tithes and offerings is for the Old Testament. Well, this person over here thinks that the tithes and offerings should be tithes and offerings. You better give your 10% and then another 10% for your offerings. This person over here says, hey, I think I'm only supposed to give 10%. And whatever offering you get, be happy. You got three different views right here. Guess what? Do you believe that you're to give God every part of you? Well, yeah. Do you believe? Well, yeah. Do you believe? Well, yeah. Everything you own belongs to Him anyway, so what does it matter? You just agreed on something. Settle it and move on. That is how you're going to have agreement and not unsettledness in your mind. God will give you that moment where you find, oh wait, I found the agreement. That's it. He will give you the wisdom. If you really are open to hear the Holy Spirit, He will show you the wisdom when there's conflict like that to find the balance. No matter what these things are that we talk about, there will be a balance. Settle it and move on. Let's read on here. Settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds. In that peaceful state, that's a key there. Let's be peaceful about it. I have a switchblade here. Should I take it out? No. I really do. To which, as members of Christ's one body, you were also called to live as members of one body, folks. And be thankful, appreciative, giving praise to God always. People who love and they're full of love, they are so appreciative. They're so grateful. I'm just so glad you're here today. This man right here, he doesn't attend our church regularly, but he's still a part of us. I feel like he's still part of the Shield of Faith. He is. He'll bring clothes. I mean, a lot of us went through those clothes. Hello, we had fun with that. His wife donated all these clothes to us. There's love. There's a bond of unity. It's love. Amen. All right. That's our scripture in Colossians. Let's talk about two more things. Two more things. Oh, the big G word that we just love. Gossip. Ugh. Let's look at the definition of gossip. A lot of us think gossiping is whenever we're tattling on someone or trying to spread a rumor that's not true, but it goes far beyond that. Gossip is casual or unconstrained conversations or reports about other people. Whoa, stop right there. It didn't say anything about lying about them. It didn't say anything about, I'm just talking about that first part right there. Unconstrained conversation or reports, because we've talked about them before. So let's talk about them again. Oh, guess what just happened? We just talked about that yesterday, but oh, did you know what happened today?
No.
Oh, man, I don't want to know, right?
Casual
or unconstrained. You know, they just lay it all out there for everybody, right? Casual or unconstrained conversation or reports about other people, typically involving details that are not confirmed as being true. Little details in stories can get so out of whack, and the next thing you know, you're believing something that's a total lie. And instead of, remember what I said we don't like? We don't like conflict. We don't want to tell someone, stop. Why do people get addicted to drugs and alcohol? Because they can't say, or no. They can't say no. They get sucked into a conversation or sucked into a situation, and they don't want to feel like the outsider. So they're like, sure, pass me the joint. It happens. How many of you have been there? Come on, y'all acting like you've never done this stuff before. All right, well, maybe you haven't, but yeah, we got laughs going now. We are all a family. We have all been in some situations. Hello. Bottom line is, we don't like to turn away people. We don't want them to feel badly about us, or we don't want them to attack us if we say no. So we tell them what they want to hear. So when someone comes to us and they start this conversation, it's very wise, like we said a while ago, just pray. Pray for that person. Say, hey, you're a Christian, I'm a Christian. Let's pray for them right now. Let's not go into all the details of things that we don't even know. All right, we're not going to labor on that much longer, but I am going to read this section out of the book. This is on page 25. Okay. James in the Bible minced no words when he wrote the negative power of the tongue. And it says, and the tongue is a fire. The tongue, a world of unrighteousness, is placed among the parts of our bodies. It pollutes the whole body, setting the course of life on fire, and it's set on fire by hell itself. Our mouth gets us in trouble. In those situations that we just talked about, it sets the course of our life. When we say something and it sits there, we can cause the presence of God to come into this place when we worship and praise Him. We change the atmosphere by what comes out of our mouth. But we can also bring demonic powers to rule. Right. Remember last week we talked about you will live in the environment you create? You will live in the environment you create. You want to be in an environment filled with the presence of God and that peace that passes all understanding? Worship Him. Speak positively about yourself. Speak positively about those who are around you. Encourage yourself in the Lord. That's scriptural. If you want to live in the gloom, despair, and agony, on me, whoa. Deep, dark depression, excessive misery, whoa. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Oh, you guys are good. Whoa. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. Y'all didn't take the bait. if we want to live in that atmosphere, keep it up. Keep going. Keep the negative, because it's never going to change. You will live in the atmosphere you create. All right, let me keep going here. So how should we respond to this issue of gossip in our church? First, don't be a source of gossip. Ouch. If you have any doubt whether something is gossip or not, don't mention it. Just don't even say it. Keep your tongue under control. Secondly, if someone in the church begins to share gossip with you, gently rebuke him or her. Can I express that word gently? Gently. You don't have to be harsh in your response to them. Well, I can't believe you came here. Oh, no, don't be harsh. Kindly say that you would rather not hear any gossip and you would hope that it wouldn't continue to spread. You can be a unifier in your church with those simple words. Okay? And if there are just a few more members like you, word will begin to travel and other church members will know that gossip is not tolerated in your church. And the congregation will be a place of joy and unity because you live in the environment you create. Amen. Love life. Love life. See good days. Control the tongue. Stop the gossip and be a unifier. The way to tell if you think what you're saying is gossip or not, where's that microphone? Don't have to turn it on. I don't think anyone will want it on. If you can't stand here with a microphone in your hand and say it to the whole congregation, it's probably gossip. That's it. I mean, it's. Hey, I've been at fault too, you guys. I'm preaching to the choir over here. I've said some things that I shouldn't have said. We all have to bring ourselves into accountability with the Lord and love each other through it as we're all walking through this process. Amen? Amen. All right. Didn't lose y'all, did I? No. All right. All right. Let's look at Matthew. We're going to talk about this next and last section in this chapter, and it's called forgiveness. Another one of those things that we as a body, a unified body, have to walk in. Matthew 6, verse 14, and we're going to also read verse 15. Matthew 6, 14 and 15. For if you forgive people their trespasses, their reckless and willful sins. Let's stop there. Now, I've mentioned this once before. There are some people, they don't even know if, I mean, they don't know they're sinning against you. They have no idea. They've never been taught. They just do it. They hurt your feelings, and they don't know they hurt your feelings. They've hurt your feelings. If you forgive people their trespasses, their reckless sins, and their willful sins. There's people who do something against you on purpose. We're not just forgiving people who, oh, just made a mistake. We need to forgive the ones who on purpose set against us to hurt us. If you forgive people their trespasses, their reckless and willful sins, leaving them and letting them go, and giving up resentment, giving it up. Say, I give up all resentment towards everyone who's ever hurt me. Your heavenly Father will also forgive you. He will also forgive us. When we forgive, we are forgiven. If we don't forgive, this is coming from page 28 in the book. Unity in the church will not happen if members have unforgiving hearts. Too many times members have anger and hurt because of something another member has said or done. Some members are angry and hurt at the pastor and the staff because of something they said or did or failed to do. I love the way Paul put it in Colossians 3, verse 12 through 13. as he spoke directly to the members of the church. Therefore, God's chosen ones, holy and anointed, put on heartfelt compassion. Kindness. Does it sound familiar to anybody? Humility. Gentleness. And patience. Accepting one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. Each local church is made up of imperfect members and imperfect pastors, imperfect leaders. We will all make mistakes, and we're going to do it. It's a fact. We will all sin. Yes, we can all be called hypocrites if you really want to get truthful. But what we do, what was that we do when we sin? 1 John 1:9. 1 John 1:9. Confess it, and he is faithful to forgive us. How much of our sin?
All.
Church unity is torn apart when members refuse to forgive, when any member is too prideful to grant forgiveness. Remember, Christ loved us so much that he died on a cross to forgive us. And now he has forgiven us, so we must forgive others. It is essential to the unity of your church. Wow. Let's all stand. Last week, I shared that at each chapter in this book, we have a pledge after we've learned each section. We have a pledge that we speak that kind of identifies with what has been taught. Last week, our pledge was revolving around being a functioning member of the church. I've given you the tests that you can take, answer the questions, find out your part, your gifts, and please take it a step farther and come to us and talk to us about what those gifts are so that you can start functioning and doing what you're made to do. People get frustrated when they're not doing what they're made to do. Take me away from a computer and away from the numbers and put me on an assembly line and I'll go crazy. I love numbers. I love working spreadsheets, but put me somewhere that I'm, no. Take me away from this pulpit and tell me I can't teach. I'll be standing out there in Walmart teaching somebody. You can't take it out of me. Right. And the same thing goes for you and the gifts that God has put in you. So here's the second pledge. Say, I am a church member.
I am a church member.
Let's go ahead and read the rest of it together. I will seek to be a source of unity in my church. I know that there are no perfect pastors, staff, or other church members, but neither am I. I will not be a source of gossip or dissension. One of the greatest contributions I can make is to do all I can in God's power to help keep the church in unity for the sake of the gospel. That is why we keep unity, because all it takes is for one person to see how we're not loving each other, and guess whose blood is on our hands? It's a very serious, serious thing. So I will be a functioning church member. Let's say it. I will be a functioning church member. And I will be a unifying church member. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you, Lord.
I just want to say a little bit. We've got about three. Yeah, got 3 minutes. You may be seated. Remember now, forgiveness is not so much for the other person, it's for our good. Did you hear what I said? It's for our good. in my ministry over the years, almost 60 years, we've dealt so with so many different people. If you're going to really walk in that happiness and that joy of the Lord, you got to be a forgiving person to release your own self. You'll be bound all your life, or I will be, if I hold resentment towards anybody. Now, you may have a hard time. I remember years ago, this woman hurt me so bad when I was learning all of this. It took me 3 months to get it out of my spirit. That thing just went down in my gut. How many of you ever experienced that a little bit? I mean, it just hurt you so deeply. And you just keep blessing that person. This is why we bless people. Jesus said that when people say all manner of things against you, blessed are you. So we bless people. And I tell you what, bless yourself. Bless yourself. Forgive yourself. There may be those here that have not forgiven themselves. And you'll never be released. It's so wonderful to be free inside, holding nothing against nobody, ain't mad at nobody. I mean, if somebody, I've had people tell me to go to hell in church, rebel, split the church. But by God's grace, I love them. I'll preach their funerals, in fact. Just say, I love people because we're all created in the image of God Almighty. And if somebody comes to you gossiping, just like that, take their hands and pray. And pray for that person, because usually it's some jealousy in them. They're jealous of you or your position. And all of us experience that, see? So we got to constantly begin to ask God, do that work in me, Lord. Do that work in me and remove. And see, as David said, Lord, if there be any evil way in me, show me and repent of it and thank God for the victory. And when you're free and you're inside of you, you act different, you look different, you smell different. You create an atmosphere in your home, in your own atmosphere, in your temple. This is our temple. And we want to make sure the temple of God in us is just full of the Holy Ghost, just full of the presence of God in it, and you feel so light and you feel so wonderful and you're not mad at anybody. It's awesome. That's the Christian life. That's the spirit-filled life. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I pray that what has been said here tonight, the whole church, universal, needs to hear this message. And thank you, Father, we'll be able to put it on the internet. And we want to thank you, Father, that we are determined to walk in the Spirit and love one another as Christ loved us and forgive one another as Christ has forgiven us. And I thank you for that right now. I speak peace to you people tonight. And Lord, there may be those that might go home and might spend a little time at the altar at home in the presence of God, asking you to cleanse me and cleanse my mouth and my tongue and help me to